Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Whatever time it might be that you're watching our worship gathering. As we begin, before we hear the music, we've added something special. Each week we light the candles. It's a sign of God's presence with us. And today we're having some special guests light the candles. And as they do so, remind us of our vision. Our vision of invited, welcomed, and loved, that we want everyone to experience that because that's what God does with us all the time, invites and welcomes and loves. Every week we're going to have a different group of kids take a moment to light the candles for us and to remind us of our vision. And so as the music begins to play, I invite you to remember that God is the one who invites you here. God is the one who has welcomed you here, and God is the one who loves you no matter what. So in this time of music, just imagine whatever worries or fears, whatever burdens that you're carrying, whatever is weighing down your heart and mind, I invite you in these next few moments simply to let it go. You might even imagine it as being in your hand, and you just take your hand and drop it down, letting it go into the hands of the one who holds it already. I invite you in these moments as we prepare for worship to let go and do just that. Let us come to God in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks that you are the God who loves each of us more than we could ever imagine. As we gather in this place, I pray that, Lord, you will enable us simply to let go so that we might in this space experience the depth and completeness of your love for us. And as we experience how deeply and completely you do love us, in the power of that love, Lord, we may grow deeper in love with you. We may, Lord, grow deeper in our love for ourselves and all those whom you place around us. And that your love working in us and in our world might bring about a world healed of brokenness, restored to hope. A world the way you intended the world to be, the way you intended us to be. And so, Lord, open our hearts and minds that we might experience your wondrous love today. In Jesus' name we pray it. Amen. As we come, I invite you to join in singing, or if you're here live physically, to hum. As Carolyn leads us in our opening song, Come Christians, join to sing.
To sing. Oh.
Thank you, Carolyn. Let us join together in this prayer. Listen and hear these words written almost 2,000 years ago. O God, you are the unsearchable abyss of peace, the ineffable sea of love, and the fountain of blessings. Water us with plenteous streams and the riches of your grace, and from the most sweet springs of your kindness, and free us from our anxious and fearful ways. Make us children of quietness and heirs of peace. In the name of the one who is the Prince of Peace, we pray. Amen. I invite you, in these moments of silence, to think about a time where you experienced peace, where you experienced a sense of God's peace, or simply a peaceful moment. And in these moments, say, God, fill me with your peace right now. I invite you to do that in the silence. Okay, I admit it. I didn't know what ineffable meant. Remember it said the ineffable sea of love? And I'm like, oh yeah, ineffable. I was like, what does ineffable mean? And what it means is it means something so amazing that you can't even express it, that it's beyond words. In other words, God's love is so amazing, so incredible, that it's even beyond any words we could use. And so often, instead of getting caught up in this inexpressible love, we get caught up in the fear. But these waters of baptism remind us when fear separates us from God's love, when it leads us to actions and thoughts and words that we regret, and thoughts that can capture us and draw us away from God's peace, from God's quiet, persistent love for us. That in these waters we can remember we are washed clean, that we are forgiven. That here Jesus reminds each of us that God loves each of us. That God loves each of us no matter what. And that's such wonderful news, such a great blessing. What can we do but sing? As Carolyn leads us in this great hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory. We're so glad to have you with us, either watching this virtually or watching it physically here and in person. And as we gather in this place, please know that we're here for you. We're here for you each and every day during the week. If you go to noon on our Facebook page, you'll find a walk that I do on the labyrinth. And you can watch it then, or you can watch it at your convenience, any time of the day or any time of the week. And each day I do a different one. And right now I'm talking about music, some of my favorite musicians. Loretta Lynn was Friday, and there'll be some others later on. Now, And again, also on Facebook, there'll be a quote each day that you can begin the morning with. And then, of course, we'll be here each Sunday on the patio at 9 a.m. and here in the sanctuary at 10:15 a.m., either streaming or you can be here worshiping with us physically. And please know we're there in the office, that we're there each week. If you want to give us a call or you want to drop by, we'll put on our mask. You can put your mask on and we can visit together. And that this church is there to invite you, to welcome you, to love this entire community. This week in particular, I want to lift up to you a way that we're loving this community with 23 other congregations in Broward County through a work called Bold Justice. And if you call us or if you get our emails, you can go to our website and look on info and we'll get you an email and you can find out all the stuff that we're doing. But this coming Tuesday night, we're going to be having a major Zoom meeting with all these different congregations to make changes in Broward County. And we'll have a lot of our leaders, our county leaders, the outgoing mayor, the incoming mayor of Broward County, will be joining us as we seek to do things like care for our youth, care for those struggling with mental illness without homes in our streets. We'll be there to care for our seniors who are often vulnerable in nursing homes. And you can find out about the good work that God is leading us to do in this work with these other congregations. So please know that we're here for you. And if there's anything you need, don't hesitate to reach out. For we want you to experience always in this place that you are invited, you are welcomed, and you are loved. Because when God's love comes, it changes us. It changes our hearts. It changes our lives. So I invite you to hear from Carolyn as she leads us into a song that is really a prayer. Carolyn.
This is what I pray.
something that happened several years ago. One of the most amazing and one of the scariest things that I've ever experienced. What it was I was traveling to a place called Zion Canyon, and I took a trail called Angel's Landing. And as you go up Angel's Landing, you eventually get to a place where the trail narrows, and it's only about this ride. Well, let me just show you. Here are some pics that kind of show you what it looks like. And so as you climb up, you kind of have two directions. Maybe show the one right before this. Yeah, that. It kind of gives you a good picture of it. Is that it's clear that if you go one side, you're going to plummet 1,000 feet down. If you go the other side, you're going to plummet another 1,000 feet down. And so you kind of realize that you really got to make sure and pay attention to the path, because if you don't, you could be in some pretty scary places. But then, if you take the path, if you go further, show the next slide, then what you get at the end is you see this. A vista so stunningly beautiful that you'll never forget being there. Being in a place where it seems only angels could land. That's where its name comes from. And right now, if we make the right steps as people, as a church, as people who follow Jesus, as a nation, as a world, who knows what wondrous sights God could have in store for us. But how do we get there? How do we get past the challenges of these days to the other side? Make sure we don't fall off the edge, so to speak. To see that, you first need to see what can get in our way. What can get in your way? You need to understand what could lead us to fall off that bridge, to fall off that trail into the darkness below. And in this story, this frankly kind of small, not very significant or interesting story, seemingly, God shows you how often it's in such uninteresting places that you can most easily fall off the edge. Now, what do I mean? Well, here in the story, God shows you the way. So let's listen and hear what God has to say. It comes from the book of Judges, 17th chapter. There was a man in the hill country of Ephraim whose name was Micah. And he said to his mother, "The 1,100 pieces of silver that were taken from you, about which you uttered a curse and which you spoke in my hearing, that silver is in my possession. I took it, but now I will return it to you." And his mother said, my son, be blessed by the Lord." And then he returned the 1,100 pieces of silver to his mother. And his mother said, "I consecrate," which means I set aside, "the silver to the Lord from my hand for my son to make an idol of cast metal." So when he returned the money to his mother took 200 pieces of the silver and gave it to the silversmith, who made it into an idol of cast metal. And it was in the house of Micah. And this man Micah had a shrine, and he made an ephod and seraphim, which is stuff priests wore. And he installed one of his sons, who became his priest. Because in those days there was no king in Israel, and all the people did what was right in their own eyes. Now there was a young man of Bethlehem in Judah, of the class of Judah, and he was a Levite residing there. And this man left the town of Bethlehem in Judah to live wherever he could find a place. And he came to the house of Micah, to the hill country of Ephraim, to carry on his work. And Micah said to him, "From where do you come?" And he replied, "I am a Levite of Bethlehem in Judah, and I'm going to live wherever I can find a place." And Micah said to him, "Stay with me, and be to me a father and a priest, and I will give you 10 pieces of silver a year, a set of clothes, and your living." The Levite agreed to stay with the man, and the young man became to him like one of his sons. So Micah installed the Levite, and the young man became his priest and was in the house of Micah. And Micah said, "Now I know that the Lord will prosper me because a Levite has become my priest." This is the word of the Lord. You know, sheesh. I mean, what a world we're facing. I mean, you could catch a virus that might not affect you at all, or it could kill you, lead you to a horrible death. You have an election that feels like it could determine the fate of the world, at least the way a lot of folks talk about it. And you have an economy that can look like it's about to fall off a cliff. Yet in the midst of all of that, you and I, we're moving somewhere. In fact, we could very well be moving someplace good, even amazing. And it also feels that we could take steps that lead us to a place that's not going to be good at all. So how do you make sure that you're not taking the wrong steps? How do you and I make decisions that lead to the right directions rather than the wrong ones? In this story, a story of tragically wrong directions, God tells you. God warns you of the tragic consequences of a small world where you and I must do, and how you and I must do all that we can to avoid living there. But you may think, oh, well, isn't a small world a good thing? I mean, it's even a ride at Disney, right? I mean, it's a small world after all. It's a small world after all. It's a small world after all. It's a small, small world. So how can that be bad? I mean, I love that ride. Well, in that famous ride, actually, that the small world is actually kind of big. I mean, you have this wondrous, amazing variety of peoples and cultures represented, of different sights and sounds. No, I'm talking about a different sort of small world. I'm talking about the world you find in this story. And what world do you find here? You find a world that centers on one small family. A world so small and insignificant, you can wonder why anybody thought it belonged in the most influential religious text in human history. Yet here it is. I mean, what goes on here? This guy, Micah, steals a bunch of money from his mom. And then he hears his mom utter this curse, and it freaks him out because he doesn't want a mommy curse. So he admits that he stole the money and returns it. So then she takes back the curse and blesses him and uses some of the money to make this silver idol for her son to keep in his house. And then Micah makes one of his sons the priest. And then Micah gets really lucky because a homeless Levite comes to town, a person who's actually qualified to be a priest. And Micah works a deal to get his own personal Levite. He even thinks, how awesome. God is going to so bless me with my own personal priest. Now, just to tell you the second part of the story, that doesn't happen. In the sequel, a bunch of folks from another Israelite tribe called the Danites, they steal the idol and the priest because they want God's favor for them. And Micah goes after them and goes, "Hey, man, you stole my priest. You stole my idol, man." And the Danites basically say, "Go home, dude. Otherwise, we're going to get really angry and we're going to kill you and your entire family." So Micah goes home. And the Danites go and they slaughter a village and live there with their new priest and idol. And that's the sort of small world I'm talking about. See, what makes this world small is everyone is relentlessly focused on themselves. Micah steals from his mom, but he doesn't feel bad about that. He just is worried because he fears a curse is going to get him. So he returns it. In other words, it's all about him. And then mom kind of gives some of the return money to God, but not to take care of the poor or the needy, but only so she can use it to make it into some sort of shining idol so God can give blessings to her family. See, everywhere you look in the story, including with the Danites who take the idol later on, everyone is focused on one central question. What's in it for me or for my family or for my tribe? And the writer even gives you this explanation for the decisions all these people are making. He says all the people did what was right in their own eyes. And when your world becomes like that, a world focused on you or your family or your tribe, it leads to a world where awful things can and do happen. In fact, right after this story, in the final story of this book called Judges, you have a woman who gets brutalized and murdered. And this horrific crime leads to the almost total genocide of an Israelite tribe. And this story and that book ends with the very same words that you find in this story. All the people did what was right in their own eyes. But you don't need that gruesome a story to see how small worlds lead to such serious consequences. A smaller story, one that the psychiatrist Scott Peck tells, shows you the same thing. This story happened to Peck early in his career when he was in his first year of residency at a hospital. And the hospital had admitted a 15-year-old boy named Bobby who was suffering from severe depression. And it was February when he came, and about 10 months before, his older brother, who was 16, had killed himself with a .22 rifle. And soon after that, Bobby began to spiral down and lost grades, all sorts of problems. And after Christmas, he got even worse. And through a variety of circumstances, Bobby ended up in Peck's office. And Peck could hardly get the boy to say anything. And finally, out of desperation, he simply asked him, "What did you get for Christmas?" And Bobby said, "Well, nothing much." And Peck dug. He said, "Dude, you had to get something. Your parents at least had to get you something for Christmas." And Bobby said, "Well, they got me a gun." And puzzled, Peck asked, a gun? "Yeah, they got me a .22. A .22 pistol?" Peck asked. No, a .22 rifle. And Peck, shocked, said, they gave you the same kind of gun that your brother had used to kill himself?" And Bobby replied, oh no. And he said, "Oh my gosh, I was concerned. I thought they gave you the same kind of gun." And he goes, no, they gave me the same gun. They gave me the same gun that my brother had used to kill himself. And when Peck met with the parents, they couldn't understand how giving Bobby the gun that his brother had used to kill himself was such a bad thing. I mean, yes, Bobby did want a tennis racket for Christmas, but hey, money doesn't grow on trees, and the gun was there. So why not just pass it on? You see, when the world becomes only about you, you stop really seeing anyone around you, even those closest to you. And when you stop seeing anyone else but you or your interests or your concerns, well, then all sorts of awful things become possible. And as blinded as you are by that self-focus, you may not even see how awful those things are. For in that small world, you have become smaller too. And in that small world, your God has gotten smaller too. God has become as small as you are. After all, Bobby's parents went to church every Sunday. They held down good jobs, obeyed all the rules. Yet they still lived in a world where making their son's Christmas gift the very con that had killed his brother an okay thing. See, because in that world, God just approves what you already believed anyway. And the same thing happens in the story in Judges. You see, after all, Micah's mother makes an idol. And don't get the wrong idea. She's not making an idol of a false or pagan god. She's making an idol of the God of Israel. She just wants a God she can handle and touch, a God she can buy, a God who will bless her choices and not challenge them. See, when I quoted those words, "all the people did what was right in their own eyes," I didn't give you the whole verse. There's a sentence before it. And that sentence reads, "In those days there was no king in Israel. Therefore all the people did what was right in their own eyes." And that first sentence tells you something important. The people had no higher authority, someone who could lead them beyond themselves to something greater than their own interests or desires. Instead, everyone had become kings of their own tiny worlds, a world of me, myself, and I, my family, my tribe, whatever. And that world had its own tiny god, too. One focused on meeting their desires and nothing else. And today, people get caught up in those same tiny worlds. You see it in the controversy around masks. Somebody will say, I don't want to wear a mask because it impinges on my freedom. So if I make you sick or a bunch of other people sick, it doesn't really matter because that's your problem, not mine. That's your world, not my world. And in such a tiny world, you resist any higher authority that would call you to care for anyone beyond yourself. And you can create a God like that too, a God who holds the same convictions you do, who hates the same people you do, who approves the same people you do. And if you're thinking right now, oh, I know who he's talking about, then don't you see you've missed the point? Every one of us can get caught up in our own small worlds with our own small God. We can all create a world where it's too easy to stop seeing and cherishing and valuing and trying to understand others, except those, of course, who we like or who agree with us. But that is not the real world. And it's not the real God either, is it? See, the real God created a world where everyone matters. A world big enough to hold us all with all our flaws and our frailties, all our strengths and weaknesses, all our differing opinions and perspectives. And into this big world, God came and became one of us. God even became small. But in Jesus, this small God did big things. This God reached out in love to everyone. This God broke past every barrier that people had put to separate themselves one from the other. Barriers between nations and states, barriers between women and men, barriers between races and ethnic groups, barriers even between the so-called righteous and the sinner. And in the end, this God did something huge. This God died for us all, died to save us all from every one of our small and self-focused worlds. To bring us back into the world that holds us all, into the kingdom of the one who saves us all. And a God who can become small like that is a God bigger and more wondrous than any of us can even comprehend. See, a God like that is bigger. It's bigger than any virus. It's bigger than any election. It's bigger than any prejudice or bigotry or division we create. A God like that shatters all our small worlds to bring us into the beauty and wonder of the real one, where the real God lives. And when God does that, it leads to amazing things. You see, on that climb up to Angel's Landing, I didn't go alone. See, for about 2 weeks, I've been traveling and camping on a bus with 30 other people from different countries, spoke different languages, as different from each other as you could possibly imagine. Ages, the whole deal. Yet over those days together, as barrier after barrier came down between us, God made each of our worlds so much larger than before. And as wondrous as a view from the top was, why don't we show that view again? Can we show that view again? Thanks. You know, what made it more wondrous was the new friends who helped me get there. And as we journey into this new world, God can make even our differences lead to our greatest blessings. But we have to be open to let God enlarge our worlds enough to hold them. So ask yourself, are there places where your world has become too small, your vision has become too little, where your world has maybe become too centered on you or your ideas or your convictions, or your tribe, your grievances, your convictions, your hardships? Is God calling you to a bigger world? Then let God, that God, set you free. Break you free and lead you deeper into the bigness and beauty of the real world. The real world where this God lives. And where anything is possible. Even arriving in a place where it seems only angels can land. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we give you thanks that you love us more than we could ever imagine. That you love this world more than we could ever imagine. And yet it grieves your heart when you see how divided we become, how judgmental we become. How, Lord, we set distinctions that you do not see between races and convictions and ideas. Where instead of being bound together in love, we're divided by judgment and by anger and by fear. Lord, you are the God who came to show us a different way. You are the God who came to make a different way. A way so powerful that not even death can stand against it. And so trusting in that way, Lord, we pray that you might lead us. That you might lead us as we make important decisions about who will be our new leaders or if we elect the old ones. You are the God, Lord, we need to lead us as we deal with this virus and pandemic. And we pray for those, Lord, who are struggling with this. Those who are struggling in hospitals and nursing homes with the virus right now. Those who are caring for them and putting themselves on the line. We pray for those who have lost loved ones to this and all those who are in grief. We pray for those who have lost jobs or businesses or are dealing with the financial stresses of these days. And we pray for a nation and a world that seems to become divided, every nation for itself. And pray that you will break down all the barriers. And you will lead us in your way, the way of love and peace. And Lord, as we pray this, I invite you to lift up whatever concerns that God has laid upon your hearts and a personal concern, a name. And I invite you in these moments just simply to lift that to God. I invite you to do that now. And dear God, as we lift up those concerns, remember the prayer that you shared with us. And we pray together as your beloved children these words. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please know that we are here for you. And we are grateful for the way that you have been here for us, not only with your prayers, but with your financial support. And if God has given you the opportunity and the provision to do so, we invite you to give to the ministry of this church so that we continue to do this ministry and the various other ministries that God has called us to in these days, including our work with these other congregations in Bold Justice and feeding the hungry and caring for orphans in Haiti. The list goes on. You can either go to our website. There's a green button at the top. You can just click on that and give there. You can send us a check at 1530 Hollywood Boulevard, Hollywood, Florida, 33020. And please know the offering plate goes both ways. If there is a need that you have, do not hesitate to reach out to us. And we will do everything in our power to be of support to you as you face the challenges of your days. And with that, I invite you to join as I lead this offering of prayer. Lord, you lead us by ways we do not know, through joy and sorrow, through victory and defeat, beyond our understanding. Give us faith to see your guiding hand in all things, that being neither lifted up by seeming success nor cast down by seeming failure, we may press forward wherever you lead to the glory of your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to join as Carolyn leads us in our closing song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. There's a series of fantasy books for kids, but they're really deeper than that, called The Chronicles of Narnia. And in these books, the image of God is this huge lion named Aslan. And in one of those books, one of the main characters, this child named Lucy, who's grown up a bit, meets Aslan. And she says to Aslan, "My gosh, you've gotten bigger." And Aslan says, "Well, that's because you've gotten bigger. The bigger you get, the more you grow, the bigger I become." And the reality is the more we grow, the bigger we get, the bigger our God becomes, the bigger this God becomes. So I invite you to be open and say, "God, make me big. Make my heart big, make my mind big, make my arms wide to reach out and be there for this world, to be there for those that you placed around me, and to know that you are a God bigger than any of my problems, any of our nation's problems or our world's problems." And I pray that this God, will be with you and surround you and bless you this day and always. This God who loved you first. This God who in Jesus, out of love, gave up everything for you, and in that even defeated death. And this God who can do more in the challenges and the difficulties of these days than anything any of us could ever ask or dream or even imagine. May this God bless you and strengthen you. and hold you in his care this day and always. Amen. And now let us go out in celebration as Jerry leads us out in song.